Hello, and welcome again to Flipped Harbor for Algebra 2. In this video, we're going to be talking about Section 1.7, Function Notation. Our objective with this lesson is to learn how to write functions using function notation. Our topics are going to include function notation, as well as the dependent variable and the independent variable of function notation. In this video, we're going to start by talking about function notation. Then we'll look at how to evaluate functions when they're given to us in equation form, as well as how to evaluate them when they're given to us as graphs. We're going to talk about what is the independent and dependent variable in function notation. And we're going to talk about how to graph a function. In that section, I'm going to remind you about the special graphing rules that I have for my class. And then we'll end with some examples. Now, function notation is whenever we write a relation in an equation where we see f of x. It doesn't have to be f of x, it could be g of x, or it could even be two totally different letters, say h of t. But anyway, these are all function notations, a way of telling us that this relation passes the vertical line test, there's no repeats in its domain, it is definitely a function. Now that x or t in the parentheses is also a nice little bookkeeping way of keeping track of what number is being plugged into the function. So let's take a look at how to evaluate a function when it's in an equation form like this. So we'll take our function f of x equals 5x plus 3. We're supposed to evaluate it at x equals 2, 3, and 4, meaning that we're going to take 2, plug it into the function wherever we see x. We're going to use our order of operations and get an output number for this function. So in this case, f of 2 is equal to 13. F of 3, plug in 3, we get 18. And f of 4 is equal to 23. Now, if they give us our function in graphical form, the f of negative 2 means that we are interested in looking at x equals negative 2, and what y value does the graph take at that point. So we go over to negative 2 on the x-axis, we move up to the function line, and we read off the y value. So f of negative 2 is equal to 2. F of 0 is equal to 4, because that's the y value that the function takes at x equals 0, the y-axis. And then finally, f of 1 is equal to 3. So we're just reading off the y values when we're given the x value. Now, the x value is what we refer to as the independent variable. It's the number that we plug into the function. The f of x, what we're used to seeing as a y, is what we refer to as our dependent variable. So when we write it in ordered pair form, we always write the x value first, then the f of x value. It's just like writing x comma y. We're just not using y equals anymore. Now if we want to graph a function, in this case this function is given to us as a mapping diagram. Remember, in a mapping diagram the arrows point from the domain box into the range box. So 3 is in our domain, it's in our x. 2 is in our range, so it's on our y. So we have the point 3 comma 2, the point 5 comma 6, 7 comma 10, and 9 comma 10. Now again, this is a function because this passes the vertical line test. Since they gave us a list of numbers, we do not draw any line on this graph. This is what we refer to as a discrete graph. When they just give us a list of numbers in any way that they do it, it could be a mapping diagram, it could be a list of points, don't draw a line. If they give us an equation, that's going to create, instead of a discrete graph, what we refer to as a continuous graph. Now, when you're making a continuous graph, right now you have to make a table of values in order to make the graph. I want to see that table of values on your paper next to the graph that table of values creates. So I get asked a lot of times, what do we plug in for x? Well, that's really up to you. I tend to kind of cluster my numbers around zero. I'll pick some numbers below zero. I'll pick some numbers above zero. I also get asked a lot of times, how many points do we have to plug in? Well, the true answer is that you have to plug in enough so that you can see the pattern. I usually start with about 5 points that I plug in. If that isn't enough to figure out the shape of the curve, then I'll start doing some extra points. But you always want to start with 5x values, plug in, get your f of x, and plot the points. If you can see the pattern, that's going to be good enough. So I decided to use the x values negative 4, negative 2, 0, 1, and 3. These don't have to be spaced out evenly. You just want to pick some little numbers and some big numbers. Again, I like to group them around 0 usually. So when I plug in negative 4, that is, I'm finding f of negative 4, I get negative 7. When I plug in negative 2, I get negative 3. When I plug in 0, I get 1, and so on. Now I've got 5 points that I'm going to put on my graph. Now, pretty easy to see what kind of graph this is going to create. These points are in a nice straight line. So I go ahead, because it's given to me as an equation, I draw this line. Now, if it was just a list of points, I would just plot the points and be done with it. Since it was given to me as an equation, I want to draw that line. And I want to remind you that you must have this table of values on your paper when you're making a graph. Later in the class, I'm not really going to be worried about the table of values, but for right now, you're going to make this table of values or you're going to lose some points. Now, this is a good time to talk about my rule for graphing. This is true whether you're doing a discrete graph or a continuous graph. You must draw the graph on graph paper. You cut that graph out of the graph paper and you glue it onto the line paper with your work for that problem. So it should be right next to that table of values. This graph should be in order with the problems before and after it. Don't put all your graphing problems at the end. It's got to be in order. Now, if you come across a problem that ever says sketch, a sketch is not a graph. A sketch is more artistic, let's say. It's not as exact as a graph. It's okay to do those problems on lined paper without doing the graph paper. If you want to do it on the graph paper, that's fine, that's up to you. Make sure you cut that graph out and glue it to your paper. But when you see sketch, you don't have to do it on graph paper. But do try to do it neatly. So, let's take a look at an example where they give us a story problem and they want us to write a function. The problem is this. Water pressure increases by 0.445 pounds per square inch, that's PSI, for every foot of depth. The pressure at the surface is 14.7 PSI. That's atmospheric pressure, basically. We want to write a function to represent the water pressure. So we're going to write an f of x type equation that's going to let us find out what the pressure is at any depth. And then we're going to use this function to find the pressure at depths of 5, 10, and 20 feet. So my equation is this. F of x is equal to 0.445x plus 14.7. That 14.7 is the pressure at a depth of 0. And then every foot down is going to add 0.445. Now if you wanted to put the 14.7 first and then the plus 0.445x, that's fine. I just put it in this form because this is more of a standard slope-intercept form. Now, we're going to evaluate. We're going to plug in and find out what f of 5 is. It's equal to 16.93. We're going to find what f of 10 is. It's 19.15. And f of 20. It's 23.6. Notice I've got everything boxed in one big box, just like it should appear on your homework. Now let's evaluate a function. We've got the function f of x equals x squared plus 9. We're going to evaluate it for x equals 0, 1 half, and 1. That means we're going to find f of 0, f of 1 half, and f of 1. We plug in 0, 0 squared is 0, plus 9, we get 9. Similarly, with the 1 half, we get 1 half squared plus 9. And I left it as a quote-unquote improper fraction. That's really how I prefer things. If you want to turn it into a mixed number, that's fine. But I prefer these improper fractions with the bigger number on top and the smaller number on bottom. They're honestly easier to work with, so I just leave them that way. F of 1 is equal to 10. Now, here's an example where we have to evaluate for a function that's given to us as a graph. So again, we're finding f of 0. That means we want to find the y value for the graph when x equals 0. We want to find f of 1.5, and we want to find f of negative 4. Now, these are all going to work out nicely because they're set up to work nicely. If you have to kind of estimate a little bit on yours, that's okay. You're expected to have to do that sometimes. Just try to be reasonable about it. If it's close to 2.5, don't get ridiculous and guess something like 2.9. So, f of 0, we start at the y-axis and we go down to our graph, and the y value is negative 5. So, f of 0 is equal to negative 5. F of 1.5, now we need to go over a box and a half, and the y value is 1. F of negative 4, we go over to negative 4 on the x-axis, and our function takes the value, takes on the y value of 1 at that x value. So f of negative 4 is equal to 1. Let's make a discrete graph now out of this mapping diagram. Now this function is telling us the daily rate for a length of stay at a hotel. So if we stay for one night, the daily rate is $65. If we stay for five nights, the daily rate is $55. And so on and so forth. So we're going to make a graph that has these four points plotted out. Because there's no such thing as staying for a night and a half or 2.1 nights, we can't fill in. We're just plotting the points that are given. Do not draw the graph. Now, you would do this on graph paper and cut it out and put it on your homework. You don't have to box in graphs. If your answer is a graph, you don't have to box it in. Let's do a continuous graph. So g of x equals negative 3x plus 12. You need to start by making a table of values. What values should you choose? It's really going to be up to you. You want to start with somewhere around 5x values, plug them in, and see what y values you get. So I made my table of values, I plotted the points, and I drew the straight line that goes through these 5 points. Again, you have to draw the graph on graph paper, you have to cut that graph out and glue it on your line paper, and you have to have this table of values. So, here's your homework. This is our first homework that actually includes some graphing. So don't forget to draw your graphs on graph paper. You might want to make sure that you get some ahead of time. You should always have some graph paper with you at home. Don't forget to glue that graph to the homework in the proper place. So, that's it for this lesson. Hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you in the classroom, and I'll see you on the videos.